Gene Shepard is a broadcaster. He is also a writer. His column appears monthly in Car and Driver magazine. He's on WOR radio here in New York from 9:15 to 10. Then we're going to talk about the human situation. That's the end of the introduction. I have none, and I have not seen you since we were together in California when we talked about the cosmic itch.
The cosmic itch that we all have, especially in New York. I guess you understand it more now.
Do I ever? We were talking about some of the remedies that are sold for hemorrhoids on the television and radio. And hemorrhoids, in case you didn't hear it. And you mentioned the relieve itching. And the cosmic itch, and you said, when you get to New York, boy, we know what the cosmic itch is.
That's right, we invented it. New York invented the crisis. They work in it like an art form. You know?
I want to talk to you about cars. We didn't do that last time, because we always talk about radio or television and such things. Yeah. Why do you write a column for Car and Driver magazine?
Well, I don't really write about cars. I write about, as a writer,
shows how much work Car and Driver magazine
are. Car magazines are much more sophisticated today, Tom, than they used to be. It's like the car is such an integral part of everybody's life that if you write about life, you're really writing about cars and vice versa.
The only thing I ever read in the car magazines, Motor Trend used to have the Detroit Listening Post, and they would tell you in 1955 what the 1956 Chevy was going to look like and everything, and I used to buy it every month to find out, and that's really all I know.
Well, that's way out of date. As a matter of fact, Tom, I'll give you an idea of my latest column. It's about driving along Route 22 in Jersey, which, as you know, is a majestic artery of total decadence. Mile after mile of instant seat cover places. You wonder what they do in Jersey. They need instant seat
cover. Let me see if I got Highway 22. You go through the tunnel down around Newark Airport, and there you pick up Route 22. And the steel
Route 22.
Goes out over through Plainfield and in through there.
Well, to me, Route 22 is the great American classic jammed suburban highway. I mean, you go past discount stores that are selling discount lawn furniture, and nobody within miles has a lawn. You know, it's but they all come and they stand and they look at the lawn furniture. You go past places like the Leaning Tower of Pizza, and it casts a shadow on the Pat Boone Hamburger Heaven. You know, and you just drive along. There's the Dairy Queen, a whole crowd of guys lined up there, and millions of cars. And this is where you see America. And the other day I'm driving along, got an idea for a column. One of the major sports in Jersey is tailgating. They tailgate. I've had guys actually with their front wheels up on the back of my trunk for miles, riding piggyback. So I'm driving along. I see in the rearview mirror this Jersey tailgater's right on, so close to me I can't even see his hood. I just see his face. Looking in my rearview mirror, see, and he's eating a Big Mac. We're going 60 miles an hour. On the other hand, he has a chocolate milkshake. He's sitting there, you know, your typical Jersey, looking around, and a rock is going. You can see his head flying around. I said, oh, God, you know, you get intimations of mortality. You see, the guy's right behind me, and all of a sudden I see directly ahead of me is this gigantic tractor trailer. Enormous. Here I'm sandwiched in between, see. And the tractor trailer, Tom, is filled all the way to the sky with squashed automobiles. 7 inches thick, you know, they go up like that. See? And I see these bumpers all looking at me, see, and you couldn't even tell what kind of cars they were. Green, yellow, blue, rust, purple. And they still had their bumper stickers on them. I'm looking at the history of the race. One says, all the way with LBJ. Another one said, I break for animals. His car was 6 inches thick. Obviously, somebody didn't brake for him. One bumper sticker said, Walt. In this red day glow tape, he said, Walt. And it suddenly hit me, my God, Walt. I could see the day in 1957 when he went down to buy that Ford Galaxy. He took Emily. They're standing in the dealership there, and it's glowing green and beautiful. And 10 minutes later, they drive out. Year after year, Walt is paying in on his thing. He's putting on Johnson glow coat every Sunday. He puts his name on the side of it. Walt. And now, where is Walt? And I kept thinking, I wanted to say something to Walt. I want to say, Walt, your car, your galaxy, do you remember it? Do you remember the Neapolitan needlepoint neoprene upholstery, Walt, that you loved?
And remember when you got the plastic the things in the mail from the people in Minnesota and says, protect
it forever, internal protection. Walt, your car's on its way to Japan.
It's in the hold.
36 payments in 1983.
It's in the hold of the funky maroon. And Walt, it's liable to come back at you as a 105 shell, Walt. You don't escape your life, and I'm driving along, and this guy behind me's eating the Big Mac, you know, spitting out the window. At that point, I says, I've got to write about this. And that's my latest column in Car and Drive.
It's what I think about all the time. They used to have the thing in Philadelphia near the airport that we used to call it the crusher. And in L.A., it wasn't the crusher, it was the grater, where they put the car in and it would chop it up into little itty-bitty pieces.
What a choice, the crusher or the grater.
The grater, right. But what you've got to say to yourself, like Walt is probably saying, ah, you dummy, Walt.
And all of us put the grinder into operation.
Yeah, $98.83 a month for 36 big ones. Right?
Yeah.
And where are they? They're, like you say,
there it is,
63.
About that big. Now, by the way, I know one guy that got so damn sick and tired of it all.
I got to tell you one thing about driving. The difference between here and California. California, the minute a pedestrian, you put your foot on the pavement in the crosswalk, everybody stops nice because it's the law. Here in New York, you just step off the curb, they step on the gas, they come at you 90 miles an hour, they dare you to come across that street.
Tom, I am sat in the back of cars, you know, I'm a great student of the cab drivers, and I speak the language, see, and so I get in and I immediately take a look at the guy's hack license. See, there's his picture there, see. And I like to call him by their first name. Myron, take me to 48th and Broadway. Myron looks in the mirror, cigar. And you go about 10, 20, maybe 30 blocks, and all of a sudden the conversation, you know, starts breaking out. One day I'm with a guy, and he says, hey, he says, look at that guy. He ain't even looking his way. You see this pedestrian walk,
a typical New York pedestrian. You know, he's got a Macy bag in one hand, a gimbaled thing in the other, you know.
He walks out in the street, doesn't look left or right. He's walking. He says, watch me give it. I sit in the back, and he goes, whoa! And we cut in between the curb and the pedestrian. He wasn't expecting something from behind. And he went up like that, and I see these two Macy bags in midair. And at that one moment, I see this guy, he's spread eagle. See, he looked like a radiator ornament.
I come across 6th Avenue and 50th Street, right outside the building here, one morning, and no traffic at all anywhere around. It's quiet, and the lights are red down to 8th Avenue, two long blocks away.
Yeah.
And the light turns green, and I'm walking against it. It took those cars one half of 1 second to get from 8th Avenue, because the minute they see you, they're ready for you.
It's an open market. In fact, you know, Tom, I think that the American, being a student of Americana, I believe that the car is such an integral part of our life. You know, here we're sitting here exchanging car stories the way men of the 19th century would exchange sea stories.
Or horse stories.
Horse stories, sure. The car is our thing. And we have a love-hate thing about it. We love the car on the other hand, and we hate it on the other hand. And a friend of mine, the guy lives in Jersey, he had this car. See,
name isn't Walt, is it?
No, as a matter of fact, his name was Frank. Bluetooth Frank. But Frank, one day, his car is gone. He's got a new car. I said, you trade your car in, Frank? Had it 3 years, the first one. He says, nah. I said, what'd you do with it? He said, I'll show you. We go into his house. Yeah, I want to show you something. Right in the middle of his living room is a 2.5 foot square cube of Crest metal. I said, Frank, is that your Dodge Coronet? He says, look at that mother, I hate it. I said, you put it right there. He says, I knew I'd find a way to get back at it.
He had it squashed, and now he's got a glass thing on the top, and people all sit and they look down at that thing, and you know, and they have the coffee.
There was a guy in California who bought a Lincoln Continental Mark IV. Now this is a high ticket car. What
do
you bet? $10,000, something like that. And he felt that he got a lemon, and he kept it for I don't know how long, 6 or 8 months, and he finally got so fed up with the car. He drove it down to Southgate, California, outside of L.A., right on the front lawn of the Lincoln Mercury Zone office, and he set fire to it.
Now, that's a gesture.
I like that gesture.
Ten grand going up in smoke.
I can see Allstate.
You know, Tom, I'm just curious.
Let me do these little announcements here.
Yeah,
we've
okay,
got 2 minutes worth of commercial time, and we'll continue with Gene Shepherd in 2 minutes, and I'll just stay tuned.
NBC announces for Thursday, a Tomorrow Show special, commencing at 1 a.m. Eastern and Pacific, midnight Central, for 6 hours. Join Tom Snyder in welcoming the Bicentennial with his guests in New York City, plus live from Las Vegas, New England, and Atlanta. The Tomorrow Show, July 4th, 6 hours, live here on NBC.
Idea.
Say that again.
I think it's a fantastic idea. 6 hours of television.
Yes, sir. All night long.
Live.
Yep, live.
That is for the first 4 hours.
I no,
like
sir.
We mesmerized.
You know, we had to talk about that, about whether we ought to pre-tape some of it, because, you know, you got to go to the John, and you got to, you know, have a cigarette or get a sandwich or something, and
I know you're going to be live, Tom, technically, but after about 4 hours of that, I can imagine you just, it's like going to a party, and you stay 2 days too long. You know?
We're not serving anything here.
You're there alive, but they only see your feet sticking out from under the daybed.
The problem that we're having, though, is you call people and say, now listen, we'd like you to come in between 4:15 and 5:15 a.m. And they look at you, or the phone goes dead is what happens. We have some open space there, Gene. Now, I know that you believe
my
in the
phone. It's just gone.
I just looking at the notes, and I mentioned to Gene that you do a 45-minute radio show. Nobody does a 45-minute radio show. It's 6 hours or telephones or
well,
what?
Tom, I don't treat radio as radio. See, I'm essentially a nightclub monologist stage performer, and I'm used to doing 45 minutes on stage. That's what I do. In fact, I play 30, 40, 50 colleges a year. In fact, tomorrow night I'll be playing Princeton.
Mm-hmm.
And radio to me is not my medium. It's just a medium. You know, so going on the air for 45 minutes, I go on just as say Mort Saul would go on the nightclub stage. I don't think in terms of anything other than
do
that.
Do you just take your whole day and you walk in and sit down in front of a microphone and say, well, folks, and you're off and rolling, or is this pre-planned?
Not at all, Tom. You can't, anybody who's tried to do a monologue knows that any good actor, I'll tell you, that sustaining an audience for, say, even 3 minutes when you're standing in front of them is tough. It takes preparation. It takes technique. It takes a beat, a tempo, and dramatic tension running through it. I don't talk when I'm on the air. I perform. Very different. Whole different character.
Not like what you're doing now.
No.
Swapping stories.
No way. In fact, I will start out, and I use silences a great deal, Tom, just the way on the stage you use space and light. And I build the show in a series just as any good monologue is built, like a one-act stage play. I build it in a series of almost like sine waves. I hit several peaks, and then as I go out off the air, there's a theme that runs through it, as I go out, which I have long since determined. For example, if I do a show one night and I want to do the show about
slide your mic up, it's slipping down on your polyester.
Okay, how's that?
That's good.
If I want to do a show, Tom, for example, about I'll take a theme, not a specific idea.
How's my mic look, Gene?
That's a pretty one.
Okay.
Very nice.
Okay.
That's Sears Roebuck, isn't it? Yes.
Mm-hmm. It goes back on the 50s.
Very good. Yeah. But I any good monologist. For example, Bill Cosby, we'll take him. Bill will go out on stage. I know how he'll work. He'll take seven or eight major stories that he knows he's going to tell. Now, the audience has the feeling he's just thought of them as he comes out. But he'll orchestrate the whole, not just a series of stories. That's the difference between a good monologist and a one-liner who comes out with a whole bunch of one-liners and then runs like hell and the marimba band takes over.
I saw Buddy Hackett do a thing one time where he started out telling a story about playing golf, and he did 50 minutes worth of material, and the end of the story, or the end of the monologue, was the end of the story he started telling at the beginning, and in between it was digression
that
sidetracks.
That's exactly the way I work. In fact, I did on stage here at Carnegie Hall this past year, 45 minutes about a kid at the age of 9 learning to play the tuba. His first moment of discovery of the world of aesthetics, staring into a silver mouthpiece and realizing that the tuba could play him. In fact, he's trying to play this thing, and the next thing you know, he's confronted with the fact that a lot of stuff is damn hard. And the moment of getting that first note out of a tuba, fantastic moment in his life. Never could turn back after that point. It was a whole new thing. Well, for 45 minutes, I sat on the stage and didn't use a word. That was a challenge that I set up for myself, where I came out and I just made sounds. Oof. Opens the spit valve and 3 gallons come out.
I got the picture.
By the way, at that point, he suddenly realized, too, that Beethoven is a lot more than aesthetics. He's a lot of sweat and pop and other things. So the point being here, to get back to your story, when I go on the air at night or when I go on television, like my TV show on PBS, it's the same, mm-hmm. that I orchestrate it as a one-act play with a mood as the theme rather than a thing as the theme. So if I say I want to create in the audience a feeling of, let's say, sardonic humor about their lives, suddenly to see their life, I will do, say, a thing just like that thing with the car. Everybody's seen these cars. Mm-hmm. Everybody's been tailgated. Everybody's gone past the Dairy Queen.
And all of a sudden, everybody is stepping back and looking right at themselves.
Exactly. And they say, well, yeah, you know. On the other hand, if I want to do a story about, let's say, fear, I don't talk about fear. I tell a story, like the night I told the story of going out on a date when I was a kid. And I, cars all shined. Got my electric blue sport coat, you know. I had a DA haircut that weighed 8-9 pounds. You know, greasy kid stuff. I was ready, seeing her with this girl. She's like alabaster next to me. We drive down the street, top down. My car has been shined. I need gas. It's a hot day. We stop at the gas station. The kid comes over and he starts putting gas in, and I get out and I'm walking around, you know, I'm looking at him. I turn to her and I says, would you like a... I won't even name the drink. Would you like a... Yeah,
I know. It's a real drink, by the way.
I know it. If I were, if just, would you like a drink, see? She says, oh, yes, I think so. And I'm being very elegant. I walk over and I get these 2 bottles out of the machine. You know, the machine's there. Ice, get them out, bring them back, give her one. I'm being very suave and I open the bottle and I'm walking around drinking whatever it is.
Cars all shine.
Cars shine. I'm on top of the world. And I'm drinking half the kids putting the gas in. And I don't know why I did it. All of a sudden, just one of those things. I take the drink up and I look at it in the sun. I can't believe it. There's 1.5 inches of dead flies in the bottom of the bottle. And I've been drinking it. All of a sudden, everything fell apart. I run back behind the Shell station and it all starts to come up. And the worst conceivable thing is happening on the date. She's looking at me. I'm sweating.
I says, I've never forgotten that moment. Every time I go to an elegant restaurant and they bring the salad, I pick up the first piece of lettuce and I expect a pair of beady eyes peering out at me. I told that story, and millions of people are listening, and all of a sudden they feel the same fear of the unexpected, the total horror happening to you. And that's the way I'll decide before I do a show. Now, it'll be funny the way I perform it on
stage. I was going to say, the difference between the way you do it on stage and the way you did it here is when you're on the stage, it's funny, right?
Yeah. Well, on stage, see, I play the whole thing. I'm the kid, you know, walking around. You know,
What was the question you were going to ask before we did the commercial?
I was going to ask you what kind of a car you had.
I don't have a car. Have no car. I sold my car when I was in California, but because here one does not need a car.
Well, did you have a car out on the coast?
Yes, sir.
What'd you have?
Well, I don't know if I'm allowed to say that I had a Cadillac when I was out there.
Well, I think nobody thinks that's obscene.
Well, I don't think it's obscene, but the people who run the network might want the Cadillac Motor Car Division to pay for that little mention.
It'd be kind of nice if you said it was a Mercedes, then they'd know you really in. But
no, all my life since I'm a kid, my father always said to me, you know, kid, if you can ever have a Cadillac, this is the supreme. So I started making a buck doing the show, and I went out and I bought this car. And right when I bought it, we had the energy crisis.
Really, you had a big gap.
Yeah, and the value of a pre-owned Cadillac went from...
I know how you feel, Tom. I've owned cars in my past where at night, 3 a.m, I could hear the car out in the garage drinking gas.
Yeah, you said that the last time we were...
Well, I know it's a terrible feeling, Tom.
It's awful.
And I went through that whole thing. You know, when you're into cars, when you really...
I love cars.
Yeah, I think
I
most of
cars.
Us do. Is that love?
Now, this one that American Motors has out, this Pacer hot car, I read about that on the business page where that's helping the company. Interesting car.
It is. It's probably, aesthetically, one of the first true departures since the late 40s of the Studebaker, the Norman Lloyd Studebaker. You remember those
cheese box on a raft?
Yeah, when they first came out.
Couldn't tell whether it was coming or going.
That's right.
I thought it was Raymond Loewy that did that.
Raymond Loewy, I'm sorry, yeah. You're right. And that was the first real breakthrough. And then I think we went through a whole period of box cars, and now all of a sudden I think this car reminds a lot of people of the Porsche.
Do you know what was parked in the Rockefeller Center garage the other day? Remember the Imperial that had the great big fins on the back with bullseye tail light? I haven't seen one of those for 10 years, and this one was all spiffed and polished, and you think, you know, we should have saved those cars.
Those are the days.
10 seconds? I can't pay this off in 10 seconds. We'll be right back after these.
Collect 212-867-1441.
Usually I'm here alone at the end, but Gene is still here because I want to get the hours that you'll be here July 3rd. What can we put you down for?
Well, don't keep the coffee hot.
Monday, we have Ted Mack coming on, and we went down and looked at all the kinescopes today of the amateur hour. And he's got one guy on there who whistles through his belly button. Now, wait till you see it Monday. You think it sounds gross when you see it.
Is he going to do it?
No.
Ted doesn't do it. The guy who got the gong does it.
Listen, I'm out of time. Thank you for coming on. You came on short notice, and I appreciate it.
Thank you, Tom.
And we will see you Monday night with Ted Mack, and have a good weekend from all of us who work the late shift here in the heart of New York City. And good night, everybody.